Good evening, boss.
Good evening, Jimmy. It's so good to be here.
And how are you tonight?
Wonderful, wonderful.
Good, good. Do you think we have enough rain yet?
Yes, we do. Over by my garden, we got 2.9 inches.
2.9?
Yes.
That's a lot. Did your garden wash away?
No, it did not. The tomato plants are hanging tough.
That's awesome. So what are we talking about tonight?
Tonight, first of all, we're really, really glad that everyone's here. Join us again for Encounter Hope tonight on this Wednesday night. And as we always do, we're going to start out tonight with God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
God is certainly good. And Jimmy, this week, we have a lot of stuff that's been happening at Hope Lutheran Church.
Okay? We always have a lot of stuff happening here, Les.
We have some really great meetings coming up, okay, in a couple weeks on a Tuesday. No, I'm wrong. It's on a Wednesday and a Thursday. I have Tuesday down. That's wrong, okay? It's a Wednesday and a Thursday on June 24th and 25th. We're going to be meeting with all high school kids that are interested in going to the National Youth Event next year. It's a huge deal. It's the 29th through the 3rd in July. And we're going to talk about costs and fundraising and where we're going to stay and all that kind of good stuff. So if you're a little bit at all interested, come to the meeting either on Wednesday or Thursday on June 24th, 25th, 5:30 in Olson Hall. Last week, I sent out some information to everybody from Hope Lutheran Church that's eligible. But I just want all you wonderful kids to know that this is open to anybody. You don't have to be a member of Hope Lutheran Church to be a part of this. So if you've got some friends that want to come along on this trip, please bring them along to one of those meetings, and we'll get you all the details coming up, okay? Then, last week, Saturday, they had a girls' day out.
Look at that social distance.
Yes, they did good. Jimmy, were you at the girls' day out?
I'm not going to tell you whether I was or not.
No, because it wasn't just all for girls. Because there we have Mr. Adams was there, okay?
Yeah.
And I know they made, I don't know what they made.
They made kits.
Kit, thank you.
So you don't know.
I don't know. Okay, I was not there either, okay? But I know that Deb was trying to take a selfie here. She told me on this one to try and get everybody in. And she said they got a lot of stuff done. They had a great group of people and just had a great time.
Awesome.
Great here at our church, okay? And then again, this week, Thursday coming up, again, we're going to go over the Feed My People. Been very successful already this morning. I have 8 people signed up already, which is awesome.
Wow.
So we probably, 15 was our record, and we could approach that this week, Thursday, okay?
Awesome.
They always need us, okay? And again, we do the social distancing, and we do the gloves and the masks and the whole thing over there.
Does Justin Davis too?
He does a wonderful of a lot of things there, Mr. Turner, okay? He's a regular over there now, okay? And then last week, Thursday, we had this drive-by steak fry here at the church. It was a huge success, okay? We really thank everyone that came to help purchase meals. We raised a little over $2,200 cleared, okay?
Wow.
And that money's going to go into Kitty for next year for the kids going to the National Youth Event and for future youth outings and some things we're doing with the youth group, okay? These were some of the awesome people that helped make it all possible that last week, Thursday. Jimmy, you look like you're sweating in this picture.
No, I just actually splashed water on me.
Oh, okay, I was going to say, were you working?
I was cleaning.
Cleaning, okay. And you were grilling. You were just kind of all-around guy. That was really good, okay? And then we had the lovely couple taking the money. Most important 2 people. Okay, for the whole steak fry, okay? You can see they have their bag money there, okay? And they were collecting funds. And then also, they had to be the bad people because we did run out of steaks, Jimmy, okay?
And they had
to tell these wonderful people we had no more food.
They weren't happy.
They were not happy. But that was Ann's job to do that. And then we had the masked man selling bird cages, okay? It looks like he had a bird cage in there, but he was selling steaks for us at the end there. So, again, just a great day. Thank you, everybody, that we're a part of that, okay? Next week, we're going to be talking about Let's Make a Deal. Jimmy, did you ever make a deal in your life?
Well, I've made a few deals in my life,
In your life? Okay, okay. But we're going to be talking about a deal that God makes with us, and that's salvation.
There you go.
Our deal for salvation. So that'll be next week, Wednesday, okay? Okay. So tonight we're going to start our service with a word of prayer, and this will be in unison.
We come to you, God, thankful for your promises. We give honor and praise to you, God of righteousness, God of compassion, God of truth, and creator of all love. Grant us pure hearts and clean hands. By your grace, give us the courage to clean out all the junk in our hearts, all that separates us from knowing your deep and abiding love. You are God, and we are all your people. We turn to you for the wisdom we need to live together as one people, one people of God. Amen.
Well, this evening, we're going to be talking about junk drawers, and we're going to compare a junk drawer to our hearts. You know, oftentimes we stuff junk into our junk drawers that we don't want, or we want other people to see. And sometimes it's the same with our hearts. We put stuff in our hearts that we don't want other people or God to see. And it's often easy to reflect on what's on the outside of our heart, and then what we look like really on our outward appearance can be two different things. But we all carry around a fair amount of inside stuff, kind of a variable junk drawer full of thoughts and feelings and attitudes that can go totally unchecked, you know, if we're not careful. Our hearts can be like junk drawers, and we all have a junk drawer at home. We know that everyone has a lot of mess in their drawer, but nobody wants to open it and let other people see it. You know, most of us are pretty private when it comes to that. But tonight, Jim, through the power of the media, through the power of this brand new, beautiful video camera we have, we're going to visit the junk drawer of our own Bonnie Hogg.
She has one?
She has one, believe it or not.
Oh, my gosh.
So let's watch. Hi, Bonnie. How are you doing tonight?
Hi, Les. I'm good.
Good. Well, Wednesday night, we're going to do a little service on junk drawers. Now, Bonnie, would you happen to have a junk drawer in this beautiful house?
I certainly do.
Wow,
I've got more than one.
Show us the junkiest drawer you have, Bonnie.
Okay.
Wow, that is
How's
a good,
this?
Good junk. Show us some of the things, Bonnie, that you have in your junk drawer.
Okay. First off,
wow.
Hope Lutheran pen.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Good. That's for writing out your offering check.
Yes, okay. It is.
Yes.
Binoculars so I can see you better.
That's good to have in your kitchen drawer.
I know it.
Okay.
And then super glue. When
okay,
things
yep.
break,
you
know,
know,
you got
you
never
know.
Know.
No, no.
And then when I need a stamp to mail a letter,
that's
you
nice.
Know, that's there.
What's that red thing, Bonnie, towards the back? What
oh,
is that, Bonnie?
Oh, that's a red nose from Walgreens. Yeah.
So that's something Steve could wear.
Yeah, yes,
yeah.
Or even you.
Wow, that's a really neat drawer, Bonnie.
Yeah.
It looks like you have a
lots
lot of things.
Stuff.
Yeah, that could just pop
yeah.
out of that drawer.
My scissor and a flashlight here. You know, there's just a lot. Mints, if you like. Mints. Oh, yeah, tape measure.
It's
you can always use that.
Use that. That is really good.
Yeah, and then, let's see, staples. For
okay.
my stapler, because
okay.
I can't get a big stapler in here.
Oh, no.
And then, oh yeah, correction fluid.
Oh yeah,
that
you're gonna
is
wrong.
Always.
Are you, Bonnie?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And then, of course, my cars.
Okay. Okay.
I don't mean plane cars.
Okay. Well, that's really nice, Bonnie. So,
yeah.
just we really thank you for sharing with us tonight
sure.
your junk drawer. Okay.
Yeah. All
thanks,
right.
Bonnie.
You're
okay.
welcome.
So, what do you think?
Yeah.
You know, I really think that helps get us the picture because not everyone would be open enough to let us see their junk drawer. But I know we all have them. Everyone has a junk drawer. But it takes a special openness to let us see it. So tonight the service is all about letting someone see the inside of us, like God. So sit back, let the Holy Spirit enter your hearts and minds. And we're going to compare our junk drawers to our hearts. So tonight, our first praise song is one a lot of us know. It's called Come, Now is the Time to Worship.
Come, now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come,
someday every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time.
Tonight our scripture lesson is from Psalm 24, and it's a psalm that David wrote telling us that clean hearts will receive the Lord's blessing. So let's listen tonight to Gary read to us Psalm 24 from the Message Bible.
Tonight reading from Psalm 24, a psalm of David. God claims earth and everything in it. God claims world and all who live in it. He built it on ocean foundations, laid it out on river girders. Who can climb Mount God? Who can scale the holy north face? Only the clean-handed, only the pure-hearted. Men who won't cheat, women who won't seduce. God is at their side. With God's help, they make it. This, Jacob, is what happens to God's seekers, God questers. Wake up, you sleepyhead city. Wake up, you sleepyhead people. King Glory is ready to enter. Who is this King of Glory? God, armed and battle ready. Wake up, you sleepyhead city. Wake up, you sleepyhead people. King Glory is ready to enter. Who is the King of Glory? God of the angel armies. He is the King of Glory.
Life has brief as it is, you know, it's a process of character development. It's a process of developing our souls. In the psalm that Gary just read for us, it says, who may climb the mountain of the Lord? Who stands in his holy place? Who will be able to stand before God? Those who have pure hearts, clean hands, and don't worship idols and never tell lies. You know, everything in life comes down to heart. Everything in your life is a matter of heart. When the Bible talks about heart, it's talking about the drawer that you have collected and stored your deepest influences. It's the center of your being. It's the determinator of your character. You know, often we talk about the heart in reference to the character of a person. We'll talk of the person, he's brave heart, fearful heart, cheerful heart, or a cheating heart, gentle heart, generous heart. Your heart is the control center of your will and your emotions and your passions that influence your decisions. From the heart is the origin of all that is good and bad and indifferent. You know, Jesus himself said, what makes a person unclean, it's not the stuff that goes into your mouth, it's the stuff that comes from within your heart. Because out of the heart comes all evil thoughts, murder, lust, deception, and slander. Your heart carries the DN code for your moral and emotional integrity. These are the things that can be in your heart. These are the things that can be stuffed in your drawer. And most important of all, your heart is the dwelling place of Christ and the Holy Spirit. It's why the condition of your heart is so important. Because Jesus Christ is light, and light and darkness cannot exist in the same place. It has to be one or the other. It's why God's work in our life is a work of transformation of our heart. It's not a work of what you're going to believe, but it's a work of transformation. It's a radical work, and the Bible compares it to having like a heart transplant. And for transformation to happen, you got to deal with what's in the drawer, the mess that's on the inside. You got to cooperate with God in exposing what is hidden. See, the heart is deceitful above all things. And you and I are very capable of some incredible deceptions. You know, we're masters of deceit and denial and contradiction. And all of us have these two realities going on. One reality is of the stuff that, you know, we have on the outside. The stuff that we're proud of. We want everyone to see. You know, we all have stuff of our houses, I think, that we're proud of. Like, when you come over to my house, I want to show off my vegetable garden. Usually weed-free and neatly all rolled. But then there are certain things at my house I don't want you to see. Like my messy basement. We all have two realities. The things that we're proud of, the things we want to be known for, and then the stuff that we hide and we're not so proud of. See, we have to understand that for transformation to happen, we have to cooperate in that painful process with God and getting below the layers, getting down to the hidden place of our heart. My friends, there is not a quick fix. First of all, we didn't get this way overnight. And I want to tell you something, that we will not be changed overnight. It's a long, painful, lifetime process. God has to do a work in us before he can do a work through us. I want to repeat that. God has to do a work in us before he can do a work through us. Again, I know we all have junk drawers at home. You got to see one of Bonnie's before. We're going to see one more tonight, and this is of Erica and Kelly's junk drawer.
Hold on, yes. Don't show them yet.
Okay.
Okay.
Hey, Eric and Kelly, how are you guys doing tonight?
We're good. How are you, Les?
Wonderful. Well, we're doing a little service on Wednesday about junk drawers. Would you guys happen to have a junk drawer in this wonderful new house of yours?
By chance, we do have a junk drawer.
So would you show Les what your junk drawer is?
Absolutely.
Wow. But that's not very junky. But tell us some of the things that you guys have in your junk drawer.
Well, we have this fun pancake turner in the shape of a jack-o'-lantern.
Wow.
I have this for muddling for mules, and my buddy Les comes over.
All right, yes, I like that. It looks stained on the end. It must have been used a couple times already when Les came over.
Perhaps.
Okay, yes, okay.
We have
this fun pizza cutter.
That's great, yep, okay.
Yeah. We have a pineapple bottle opener.
Oh, in case
for
you want a
cold
beer,
beverage.
Yeah, or Coca-Cola. Okay, yes.
We have a tongs to take our toast out of the toaster.
Bamboo. So it's not dangerous to put in the
bucket. Oh, what's that silver thing, Kelly, way in the back? That's interesting. Now,
oh,
what's that?
It's from a pampered chef, and it makes little sandwiches. When my kids were little, we used to make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches with this.
That doesn't look like that used very much.
Not a lot.
Unless you cleaned
it a
little
bit.
Okay.
This is one of my favorite things.
Yes?
This is the wine opener.
Oh, it's, yes.
Yeah, it's a corkscrew.
You have a lot of drink-related items in your junk drawer, don't you?
Are you surprised, Les?
No, not. That's very nice. Well, guys, that's really nice. It's an interesting junk drawer, and some of the stuff looks like it could just kind of spring out of that drawer.
Mm-hmm.
So thanks for having me tonight, guys, okay?
Absolutely.
You're welcome.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
We all have junk drawers. And when people come over, you know, we hide stuff in our junk drawers. You know what we really do? What we really do? You know what the junk drawer is really about? It's really about putting off decisions. About what we keep and what we put away. That's what a junk drawer really is. We're putting off decisions. But eventually we got to deal with it. Or else what happens? The junk drawer gets, you know, mad at it, and you get it stuck, and you can't get it open, and you keep cramming stuff in until it won't open at all. Sometimes it's the same way with our heart. It's the things that people do not see that we keep cramming down, like the attitudes and the behaviors and some of our passions. They're just under the surface. But then a time or conflict comes or stress comes, and guess what? It goes BAM! And it opens up, and it's for everyone to see. We all have these unresolved heart issues. And one of the major unresolved heart issues is that we got to deal with in this progression towards seeing God better is unforgiveness. The unforgiveness. Many of us probably are holding on unforgiveness against someone. It could be a parent or a relative or an ex-spouse or ex-boss. And as long as you have unforgiveness, you have an emotional focus that's always tied to your past. And you can never progress forward to that place, to that mountain of God, because you're always tied back there to the past. And it binds you to the pain and the hurt from that past experience. You know, my friends, here's the things about unforgiveness. You think that somehow you're punishing the person that, you know, you're not forgiven. You're sitting there at night and the pain and the hurt comes back because you never let go. And you come into a time of difficulty and stress, and that's when all the stuff comes to the surface, you know, out of your heart. And you're losing sleep at night, and you think you're punishing that person that you're not going to forgive. And you know what? They're sleeping like a baby. And until you're willing to forgive, you're never going to cut that cord that binds you to that pain, that holds you to the past. Here's another heart issue that we put down in that drawer. It's called lack of discipline. Many of us are undisciplined. We have a pattern of starting projects or activities and relationships. And at a time of stress or difficulty, we quit. That is much tied to an unresolved heart issue of self-worth and self-esteem. If you have trouble with discipline, it's an unresolved heart issue. You know, have you ever said to yourself, man, I'm going to read my Bible every day. Or I'm going to do a daily devotion. or I'm going to give the Lord 10 minutes a day in reading and prayer. And they don't have the discipline to carry it out. This can be a hard issue of lack of discipline, something we like to push down in our drawer. Here's another hard issue that we got to deal with, and it's one that I have to deal with because I'm trying to be honest here. It's called unresolved anger. I can have hot button responses. You know, I go along and things can be real cool, and all of a sudden I hit a conflict and stress, and bam, it jumps right out of my drawer. I don't deal with anger. I don't talk it out. I keep stuffing it in my drawer. And then periodically it erupts. This is what Jesus said. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. Deal with your anger every day. If you are angry, be honest about your anger. But at the end of the day with that anger, don't just put it in your drawer. Or you're going to have to deal with it. It's a hot button response. You can ask my daughters about this. I love to hold back all my anger and frustrations pent up inside, stuck in my drawer. And then all of a sudden when I'm stressed or I don't get enough sleep, bam, it comes out. And sometimes it comes out at some innocent person. Every day we need to deal with our anger, our frustrations. I want to tell you, my friends, that a pure heart requires radical changes, radical treatment. A lot of us come together in this faith community, our church. And we think that for transformation to happen, we're looking for some like spiritual hug or something from God. But if God could have saved you and transformed you with a hug, God would have given you a hug. But it took something more radical than a hug. It took a cross. And to realize that I am helpless against the disease, and that I need this radical treatment of what God has done in Jesus Christ through his death and resurrection. And it's only when we are willing to be honest and open with our Lord can transformation happen in our lives. We all know we need the radical treatment of the cross of Jesus Christ in our lives. Again, God has to do a work in us before God can do a work through us. God has done everything necessary that you and I need for this transformation in giving of his Son. Tonight, you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and make that transformation happen, to clean out the junk from your heart and be one with God. And tonight, my good friends, this is truly the word of the Lord for today. Amen. Let's pray. We lift our heads and our hearts and our hands in praise to you, Christ, our Lord. You are our strong and powerful God. You are our salvation from all that limits and blocks our love for others. Grant us your grace, grant us your peace, and grant us the power of your love to clean out the junk from our hearts in our everyday lives. Amen.
This next song, Les, is one of Gary's favorites. This is a what I call a praise medley. Yeah, he's back here with his hand.
Yes.
We've done this a couple times in church, and when we get to the part here where it's like a little bit of a round, Gary and I and all you men out there are going to join together, and the ladies are going to support us as following up with the same response. You'll see that on the screen as we go along. But the first song we're going to be singing is God Has Made Me Glad. All right, here we go.
I will enter God's gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter God's courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. God has made me glad, yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. God has made me glad, yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad.
Let's do the first verse and chorus one more time. I will
enter God's gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter God's courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. God has made me glad, yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. God has made me glad, yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! God has made me glad. Hallelujah! God has made me glad, hallelujah. God has made me glad, hallelujah. God has made me glad.
God has made me glad,
yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. God has made me glad, yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. God has made me glad, yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. God has made me glad, yes, God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad. I will rejoice, for God has made me glad.
All right, we're going to change it up a little bit, and we're going to be talking about how we call upon the Lord, okay? Here we go, Gary.
I will call upon the Lord.
Transformation that happened in our hearts, it took something very radical. It took a cross. We all need the radical treatment of what God has done in Jesus Christ through his death and resurrection. Go now, being willing and honest and open with your Lord, so transformation can happen in your life go in peace. Amen.
Do you know the song, Les?
I know the song, Jim.
How does it go?
We'll sing it.
We'll sing it,
together.
Yes.
Okay, okay,
it's
okay,
another
okay.
Cam song we've done at
okay.
Luther Park.
I'm just checking.
Wednesday for Let's Make a Deal, Jimmy.
Let's make a deal.
Okay, God bless. See you next week, Wednesday.